He was in St. John's, now he is in Sagar and Manipal hospitals.
I think we all know each other.
I know, but
some hi, of the Naga. Students...
Hi.
So, welcome, Naga. I think Dr. Raji will join shortly. So, last week, we had a generic discussion on the principles of transplantation surgery, the immunology, the management of rejection, and you know, and it's the how you manage immunosuppression following transplantation. Now this class is organ specific, the technical aspects of each transplant and the problems that thereof. So Indraja, please start, share your presentation and start.
Good evening to everyone. I'm
Indraja, you are not sharing your screen.
So, one second, sir. I already shared.
Are you all able to see her, son?
Yeah, we can see.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, yeah. Dr. Nooli, are you there, sir? Okay, Indraja, start.
Is it visible, sir?
Yeah.
I'm Dr. Indraja, first year general surgery resident in Sagar Hospital. In previous class, I discussed about basics of transplantation, different types, immunology, and immunosuppressive therapy of transplantation. Today, I'm going to discuss about organ donation types of donors and different types of organ transplantation like kidney, liver, small bowel, and pancreas transplantation. And coming to the donors, donors may be of two types, living donors and deceased donors. And living donors, transplantation in case of living donors is limited to the kidney and in less extent in liver and lung. And deceased donors, there are two types of deceased donors. One is brainstem dead heart beating donors. It is also known as donation after brain death and donation after circulatory death. Donation after brain donors, they provide almost all organs for transplantation. And after circulatory death, mostly kidney, liver, and pancreas, lungs will receive from these patients. And there are different referral and concern for organ donation. One is required request or required referral, all patients who are dying in ICU setup are referred to the referred for organ retrieval, sir. And opt out or presumed consent. This is the individual choice to donate the organs. Donation after.
Indraja, are you sure about what you said right now?
Yes, sir.
Because as far as I knew, that opt out is in certain countries where it is compulsory for donation and you have to opt out like that.
Sir, that is an individual choice, and whoever signed for the organ donation previously, they will take from those patients.
Yeah, I think you should be clear, Indraja.
Yes. See, no, opt. Sorry. Yes, can Naga. Can I just yes, have a word?
Yes, Naga.
See, the opt-out is a situation wherein it is presumed that the patient has, or the person has given consent. Unless you say, I do not want to give, it is presumed that I have given consent. This is only in certain countries this is available. And so that is why it is also called as presumed consent.
Correct.
If somebody has not signed for an opt-out, that means he is willing to donate.
Correct. I think...
Whereas in a country like ours, we have to sign a specific consent to say that we need to donate, even after the death.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
And donation after brain death. It is also called heart beating deceased donors, and the acceptance of the brain dead donors it brought a major transformation in case of organ transplantation, and it is defined as permanent functional death of the brain stem, neither conscious or nor spontaneous respiration. And it is the complete irreversible cessation of all brain functions. The diagnosis of brainstem death, the patient must suffer from major brain damage of unknown etiology, and the patient should be deeply unconscious and require ventilatory support. And we must exclude that muscle relaxant agents or CNS depressant drugs that are not contributing to the clinical picture. And we should rule out the hypothermia, profound hypotension, and metabolic and hormonal conditions that may contribute to the CNS depression before diagnosing brainstem death. And there are different clinical tests for brainstem death. These includes eliciting the absence of cranial nerve reflexes, and absence of motor response, and absence of spontaneous respiration. Donation after circulatory death, it is classified based on the Maastricht classification. It includes 5 categories. And the category 1 includes dead on arrival at hospital, and category 2, resuscitation attempted, but it couldn't success. And category 3, awaiting cardiac arrest after withdrawal of the support. And category 4, cardiac arrest while brain dead, and category 5, cardiac arrest and unsuccessful resuscitation in hospital. Evaluation of the deceased donor, these includes ABO typing.
Indraja?
Yes, sir.
Go to the previous slide.
Yes, sir.
In this, there is two types of categories, okay? One is uncontrolled
donors and controlled donors, sir.
So just explain it, yeah.
Uncontrolled donors are type 1, 2, and 5, and controlled donors are 3 and 4, sir. For uncontrolled donors, warm ischemic time is not stable in case of
uncontrolled. Yes, correct. It is not predictable, yes. The duration of warm, it is longer sometimes. Yes. That's why.
Mm. Can I continue?
Yeah.
And evaluation of the deceased donor.
You go back to the two slides before. See this clinical testing of brainstem death. I think you need to elaborate a bit more as to are you coming to that? That is, how many people who have to declare the patient has brainstem death?
There are
legal requirements of
the
that.
The team includes 2 members. One should be the consultant, and the 2 members should not be the part of transplant team, sir.
Yeah, yes. I think all these things have to be made very clear. Yes. See, the patient, you know, the treating team or the team that is going to take the consent for transplantation should not be involved in the declaration of brain death or brainstem death, because there will be supposed conflict of interest. So hence, it should be made clear that the 2 independent evaluators who are not involved in the transplantation process are requested to independently declare the patient brain dead before the brain death is confirmed, and then the patient's relatives are counseled regarding transplant organ donation.
Sir, Ajit here, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, do we need 2 neurologists or any physician will do, sir?
See, basically what we have to look at is diagnosis of brainstem death is one entity. Whether it is used for transplantation or not is a second question. Okay. Whenever you are declaring, till recently, when we say somebody is certified dead, it always meant clinical death. Whereas, once the concept of brainstem was accepted by law, which means you can diagnose and declare somebody as brain dead and remove the support irrespective of whether they are going in for transplant or not. So the way the brainstem is diagnosed are the criteria which are already given. There are tests which are done, which include obviously a cold calorie test, making sure that there are no other parameters which are affecting the test, as well as there should be no response and there should be no breathing. Okay. Now these have to be followed, and in certain countries, even EEG is done. Okay. Now, once the brainstem is suspected by the treating clinician, he calls a set of people, or the hospital has a board which certifies that whether the patient is dead or not, irrespective of, even though in Organ Transplantation Act, it is mentioned that two neurologists, the clinician and the head of the institution, are the people who are minimum required for certification. In most of the countries, it is always that there are two independent neurologists who diagnose brainstem death independently of each other, and these tests are repeated at least twice with an interval of 6 hours between them. Okay, so this has to be, this is the protocol, and then the certification process occurs. Now, when you have a patient coming in for transplant, then you may follow everything to take consent for donation and all that. Otherwise, you can withdraw life supports and declare him dead legally. Go ahead, please.
Is that clear to everybody?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Continue, ma'am.
Evaluation of the deceased donor. We have to evaluate the donor for ABO typing and different serological tests, and angiogram, intravenous urography, and HLA typing. We have to look for other conditions like presence of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. This is the absolute contraindication for transplantation, and other HIV and hepatitis B and active systemic sepsis, and the presence of malignancy within past 5 years, and the organ should be free from the primary disease, and we have to identify the marginal or suboptimal donors. Marginal or suboptimal donors are the donors of more than 75 years or 60 to 69 years with comorbid conditions are known as marginal donors. Compared to the death after circulatory donors with brain death donors, outcomes of the organs from the circulatory death compared to the brain death donors. In case of kidneys, there is increased incidence of acute tubular necrosis that results in the delayed resumption in the renal function that leads to the post-transplant dialysis in more than half of the recipients. In case of liver transplant, there is higher incidence of chance of primary non-function that leads to the urgent retransplantation, and also poorer graft and patient survival. In case of pancreas transplant, there is higher incidence of graft thrombosis and pancreas loss. Principles of organ retrieval, there should be adequate exposure is needed, and we have to and the control of vessels above and below the organs to be retrieved. And we have to initiate the preservation and adequate organ packaging and removal of the iliac vessels for vascular reconstruction in case of pancreas and liver grafts. And organ preservation, in the absence of the circulation, most of the cells rapidly switch from aerobic to anaerobic metabolism that leads to the increased energy consumption and depletion of the intracellular energy stores that leads to the accumulation of the toxic metabolites. So the purpose of the organ preservation is to overcome these changes. This can be achieved by the cooling, the metabolic rate is half rate temperature below 10 degrees centigrade and 4 degrees centigrade, that is 10% of the normal body temperature. There are two terms, warm ischemic time and cold ischemic time. Warm ischemic time is the interval from the withdrawal of the life support to the initiation of the cold storage, and cold ischemic time is from starting of organ cold organ preservation to the removal of the graft from cold storage. There is it is a cold ischemic time is different for different organs. For kidneys should be transplanted within 18 hours. For liver, it is around 12 hours, and pancreas within 10 hours we have to transplant, and for small intestine less than 4 hours, and heart and lung we have to transplant within 3 hours.
Can you just go back? Sorry, can I?
Yes, sir.
See, go back till from the donor workup. No, next, yeah. Now, see, since we are, I presume this is a seminar on transplant, no? Now, what you need to do is all these things have to be elaborated upon. Because at an undergraduate level, if they say you have to do ABO grouping, okay, and HLA typing, no? They will say very good. But at a postgraduate level, you need to expand on that and say, what are you looking for? What does it mean to you?
Naga, those were all explained in the last class.
Last class.
Okay, fine. Sorry.
Sorry.
Sorry. Then go ahead, please. Yeah. Sorry.
Can I continue, sir?
Yeah.
Okay. Can we stop at donor? Donor organ retrieval. Yeah.
Yes.
Has anything been covered in the last class for this?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. Now discuss this. Discuss the donor organ retrieval.
Yes, sir. Sir, we have to first.
Don't worry, Indra.
No, don't worry.
Just talk.
It is all right. You can make any mistake now. Okay, you don't have to clam up. All you need is to do is, the idea is that everybody understands what it means. That's all. So that you don't have to again go through reading it tomorrow.
Yes. So we have to clam the vessels of the organ, whatever we are retrieving.
Ordinarily, okay, let us look at it as a deceased donor, right?
Yes, sir.
Whenever there is a deceased donor, all the organs can be taken, which means the heart, lungs,
liver,
intestine, yes, kidneys, pancreas, blood vessels.
Yes, sir.
All these can be taken, right?
Yes, sir.
So obviously your incision is going to be from
median sternotomy, midline incision, sir.
Midline incision through the median sternotomy to pubic symphysis.
Pubic symphysis.
Right?
Yes.
Now, what is the next step? What are you going to do? In what? You don't have to say everything. All you need is to look at which is the order in which you take the organs.
Anybody, Ajit or Saurav, do you know which order do they take the organs? Ajit, Saurav?
No, sir, I don't know.
Which order do you think you should take?
Sir, in case of thoracic organ procurement, first heart is to be taken, sir.
Yeah.
Then lungs separately or together.
Okay. Hmm.
And in case of abdominal organs, small bowel is more sensitive for ischemia. So that has to be retrieved first.
Hmm.
Then pancreas, then liver, sir.
Hmm.
Finally, kidneys.
See, what you have to do is, first thing is, you have to prepare for perfusion. How do you perfuse? You have to cannulate the aorta at the junction of aorta into iliacs. Okay, get ready for grafting. The moment you cross clamp, we are talking about the abdomen now. The moment we cross clamp the aorta, which is above, just below the diaphragm, okay, and high above the liver and just below the diaphragm, you can start the perfusion. When the perfusion starts from below, obviously you have to allow the venous drainage to occur. So you open the IVC, okay, so that all the blood starts draining out and the perfusion with the cold fluid starts. So before we do anything, we have to do, even touching the organs, we have to perfuse them with ice cold fluid. By doing that, the metabolism comes down, number one. Number two, all the blood which is in the veins and the capillaries get replaced by this ice cold fluid, okay? So the clots are all removed. This may be usually a ice cold Ringer lactate solution. And once the blood is cleared off, then we use special solutions to preserve the organs, okay? And once that is done, you start mobilizing the intestine, push it up, go on to the aorta and the IVC and take off the organs one by one, okay?
Yes, sir.
Majority of the times, at least in India, the liver transplant surgeons will be the ones who will do the abdominal surgery most often, because they want to make sure that they get a good length of the veins and along with the IVC and the portal vein. They are very, very particular about that. So that is why they come and harvest the liver. After they leave, the other fellows will come and take whatever they want. Okay, but yes, when we are thinking of taking the bowel should be taken first, followed by the liver.
Okay.
Yeah, tell me. And once the organs are retrieved, they are packed in ice cold fluid, which is the special fluid. Let us say, for example, for liver and the kidney, we use what is called as University of Edinburgh solution. Okay, not the USOL, which is used in dressing rooms. You should know very clearly that it is entirely different. Okay?
Yes, sir.
And our University of Wisconsin solution.
Is that more expensive, Naga, which is why you use Edinburgh solution or...
Sorry?
Is the UW solution more expensive than University of Edinburgh?
No, it is more or less the same.
Huh.
It is depending upon the availability.
Okay.
We use it. Okay. And then there are so many solutions which are available. Primarily, all of them have certain things in common. Okay. They need to have a high osmotic activity. Okay. Now, what happens whenever there is ischemia? You need to understand that every cell, the sodium potassium ATPase pump is the one which goes when the ATP goes down. And when that goes, the fluid starts getting in. So there will be a edema, or the cell starts swelling. Along with that, because the sodium potassium ATPase pump is lost, you will find that potassium starts leaking out, sodium starts going in, all this happens. So these changes have to be tackled. That is why the basic principles in all these solutions, they have high osmotic pressure as compared to normal plasma. They have high content of potassium. They have buffers which keep the pH range in a very narrow margin by about 7.4, because the cells start becoming acidotic. And then there is always that magnesium ATP, which is in the system, which can give ATP and keep the cells going. These solutions can be perfused manually, or sometimes even there are pumps which are available, which will keep perfusing the organ at certain pressures. And when your pulsatile perfusion is there, the organs can be kept for a longer period of time. However, on a routine level, once we perfuse, we put them into those solutions and use a triple layer of material to transport. The first cover will have the organ with the solution. The second will have ice slush, which gives the cold. And the third one, again, will have some ice slush, and you do it in the third, all are tied off and labeled and sent. Okay. This process should be very, very clear, because if not today, any time in your life, you may be asked to do this job wherever you are. Okay. Because organ transplants are becoming common, whether it is in Sagar Hospital, whether you live somewhere else, this you should know. Yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah, thank you. I think that was extremely good. Okay.
Can I continue, sir?
Yeah.
In organ preservation, there are various solutions available. On this University of Wisconsin solution and Urocollin solution, but most commonly used is University of Wisconsin solution.
Can we just go back to one definition, please? That warm ischemia time.
Yes.
See, the warm ischemia time starts the moment the perfusion or the blood flow stops. The moment you cross clamp the aorta, the warm ischemia time starts, and it ends with cold perfusion.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, the cold ischemia time starts from the time of cold perfusion till the actual perfusion is started after transplantation.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So it is not removal of the graft from cold storage.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
This you have to correct.
Okay.
From the beginning of the cold perfusion
to the,
okay. And that is why this 18 hours is the cold ischemia time, or a total ischemia, which is both warm and cold ischemia put together.
Okay, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir. And University of Wisconsin solution, it is most commonly used preservative for all intra-abdominal organs. It includes various components. And as explained by sir, most of the adenosine, it is used for ATP synthesis during the perfusion, and glutathione, it is act as free radical scavenger, and allopurinol, it inhibits xanthan oxidase, and it inhibits generation of the free radicals, and magnesium and dexamethasone, these are the membrane stabilizing agents, and phosphate is used as for hydrogen ion for buffering quality. Kidney transplantation, the incidence of end-stage renal disease is greater than any urological malignancy, and most of the patients die annually because of the end-stage renal disease compared to any urological malignancy. And end-stage renal disease, it is defined as permanent renal failure in adults, and it is irreversible glomerular filtration rate of less than 10 ml per minute, or serum creatinine level of greater than 8 milligrams per deciliter. There are different causes for end-stage renal disease. These include glomerular nephritis, diabetic nephropathy, renovascular disease, and obstructive uropathy, polycystic kidney disease, and systemic lupus erythematosus, analgesic nephropathy and several metabolic diseases and tumors like Wilms tumor, renal cell carcinoma, and there are congenital causes like horseshoe kidney and irreversible acute renal failure like cortical necrosis or acute tubular necrosis. Evaluation of recipients for organ transplantation in case of kidney transplantation. We have to evaluate.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can we just go back to this slide? No, see.
Yes, sir.
These are all the causes for ESRD.
Yes, sir.
Indications for renal transplant are very, very clear. Okay.
Yes.
Indications for renal transplant is ESRD.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Commonest cause being diabetic nephropathy.
Nephropathy, yes.
And the second being chronic glomerulonephritis due to various causes. Rest of them, yes, complete the list. Can you just go to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
See, most of these are not indications for
renal kidney transplant.
Kidney transplantation, because any person who has a malignancy has to wait for 2 years after the malignancy is cleared before he can undergo a transplant. Because the moment you immunosuppress, the so-called micrometastasis will start growing and the disease is likely to come back. Okay.
Yes.
That is why they don't really become direct indications for renal transplantation. Similarly, horseshoe kidney is never an indication for renal transplant. Horseshoe kidney people can lead a normal life. If they develop ESRD due to diabetes or whatever, then ESRD becomes the indication and not because he has a horseshoe kidney. Okay.
Yes,
same thing whenever there is irreversible renal failure, not acute renal failure, renal failure, again, it goes back to, so these things confuse the picture. You should have a very, very clear acute tubular necrosis, more or less by definition means that it will come back to more or less normal because only the tubules are involved. If the glomeruli are involved, then they become cortical necrosis. They don't come back. Okay.
Yes,
so these distinctions have to be made when you are talking about these, and none of these become direct indications for, you know, a renal transplantation.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please go ahead.
Evaluation of recipients for organ transplantation. You have to evaluate the patient for presence of underlying any comorbid conditions. And we have to diagnose the cause of the primary renal disease and exclude the malignancy and systemic sepsis. And patient should be psychologically stable for ongoing transplantation. And the patient should find the financial support to the patient and evaluate need for any preparative surgery needed to facilitate for facilitate before transplantation. The criteria for renal donor selection are there should be absence of renal disease.
No, Dr. Janani, go back.
Indraja, sir.
Elaborate on this. What do you mean by all this?
So, we have to look for with any comorbid conditions are there or not, underlying comorbid conditions, and we have to diagnose the primary renal disease, the exact cause for the end stage renal disease, and we have to rule out the underlying malignancy or systemic sepsis that affect the graft after survival.
No, nature of the primary renal disease, no.
Yes, sir.
Why do you need to do that? Anyway, the kidney is dead.
Because it will affect the transplanted kidney also, sir, afterwards.
Some of the diseases, which is the cause for the primary renal disease, could also affect the graft. right? Yes. If there is an obstructive uropathy which is causing the renal disease, that has to be corrected. That is why you need to know the nature of the renal disease or what caused the renal failure. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, age. What about the age?
Most if you are doing a transplantation, old age patients, the complications after the transplantation is more, sir.
What is the cutoff? Beyond which age do they usually not transplant people?
After anybody? 60.
Not after 60.
No, see, age, no, what is this? See, the importance of age is, number one, as age increases, let us say beyond 60, the risks of surgery outweigh the risk of patients being on dialysis, right?
Yes, sir.
That is why we would prefer that the patient be on dialysis. That is one part. The second part is, especially in children or very young adults, okay, the growth will be get affected because of renal failure. In these patients, you will do transplant more urgently and will not leave them on dialysis for long periods of time. Right? If a child is there, the moment the serum creatinine is 3.5, we will even push for what we call as a preemptive transplant, because we need to get the child to grow as normal as possible. Okay, that is the importance of age.
Naga, is there any age beyond which you don't transplant? 70 years is cut off.
No, right? It is not really like that. It primarily depends upon the fitness.
Fitness of the
patient. But when it comes to a cadaver program, okay, anybody beyond 60 starts getting negative points as the age is higher.
Okay.
That is basically because paucity of organs.
Yeah.
When somebody comes with a life-related donor, okay, age is not really a criteria, though we try to discourage beyond 65 and all that, because there is no point putting a 30-year-old kidney to a 70-year-old man.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead, Dr. Indraja.
Yeah.
The criteria for donor selection, the donor should be absent from the renal disease, and there should not be any active infection, and there should not be any transmissible malignancy, and there should not be any comorbid conditions like diabetes and hypertension. And the criteria for deceased kidney donor are normal renal function and no underlying comorbidities like hypertension, diabetes, and no malignancy other than primary brain tumor. And the age should be between 50 to 60 years. And the deceased donor should be negative from the syphilis, hepatitis, and HIV. The expanded criteria.
Yes, please.
This one, sir.
Previous.
Yes, sir.
No, just wanted to ask whether extra renal malignant patient can donate.
Yeah.
And patient having extra renal malignancy like stomach cancer, all like that, non-metastatic, can you donate?
Not sure.
I think no, sir. Only means in books they have mentioned only brain tumor or superficial skin cancer, sir. No other malignancies than these two, brain and skin.
Correct.
Right. Why? What is the reason?
Because I can only guess that the other malignancies has a potential for coming back, and especially if this patient who's on immunosuppression, there is potential for the
donor. Stomach cancer donor can't donate kidney.
I don't know whether is it due to micrometastasis or anything which.
No, can you donate or not? I don't know. That's what I'm asking.
Naga.
No. Hello.
Yeah.
See. No malignancy except intracranial malignancies are taken as donors. Okay, anybody who has had a malignancy, generally we do not take them as donors, even if they are cured, because there could be micrometastasis in the kidney. The moment we give immunosuppression, it could flare up. Only things like astrocytoma and all are not known to produce secondaries, elsewhere. That is why that is an exception.
Okay, thank you. Continue, ma. Rikant, has it answered the question?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
And expanded criteria for deceased kidney donors. These includes age older than 60 years old or donors 51 to 59 years old and with following risk factors like cerebrovascular death, hypertension and serum creatinine level greater than 1.5 milligrams per deciliter. And the surgical goals of in case of kidney transplantation includes we have to minimize the warm ischemic time and we have to preserve the renal vessels and preserve the ureteral blood flow.
How do you do all this? Expand. Describe this. How do you minimize warm ischemic time?
Indraja?
Yes, sir.
I think last class Dr. Rajiv Lochan did tell you how to minimize the warm ischemia time. Anybody else? Ajit?
Sir, I think you will give IV mannitol, sir, to reduce the ischemia. Get everything ready. And the surgical techniques, it should be proper surgical techniques. And IV heparin diuretics.
Naga, anything to add to that? Hello?
Naga Subramaniam, sir.
Naga, I think he
has left. He's there.
Yeah, no,
he's a phone call, I think.
Yeah, he had a phone call. Naga, the warm ischemia, how to minimize the warm ischemia time? So,
the warm ischemia time can be minimized only by surgical techniques, that's all.
Yeah.
For example, whenever you are doing a donor nephrectomy, if you are using a laparoscope, it's going to take a slightly longer ischemia than open.
Yeah.
Okay. So, that's all. And second thing is keeping everything ready. That's all you can do. There will be certain warm ischemia time.
Yeah.
We have to minimize that by keeping things ready.
So, giving mannitol and all those things don't help.
No, that is not for warm ischemia.
Yeah.
They are all given to prevent renal failure. See, basically what mannitol does is exactly like what I told you. What mannitol does is it dehydrates the tubules.
Huh.
It is an osmotic diuretic. It goes inside. During the donor surgery, donor nephrectomy, we always give mannitol. Okay. When mannitol is given, it improves the perfusion because it expands the volume of blood. When it goes into the tubules, it dehydrates the tubular cells. So this itself That is why it protects the kidney when the ischemia occurs. Okay, so yeah. That is why it is given. It is not to minimize the warm ischemia time. And it is not preserve the renal vessels. You have to choose and take the maximum length of vessels possible.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it is not the preservation of renal vessels. You should have a good length of the vessel for you to anastomose.
Yeah. If there are multiple vessels in the donor, then you have to take a aortic patch, including all of these rather
no,
than...
No, normally, see, I'll tell you. The criteria for selection will be generally a single vessel.
Yeah.
Especially the artery.
Yeah.
If there is one artery on the right side and two arteries on the left, we would prefer to take the right.
Correct.
If both sides show one, we would prefer to take the left because the left renal vein is longer.
Longer, yeah.
Okay. Which helps us technically on the recipient side.
Right, yeah.
And more than that, before we come to the vessels, what we have to look at is, we have to see whether there is any problem with the kidney. Suppose there is a cyst in the kidney. That kidney has to be taken for donation.
Okay.
You cannot say, no, there is a cyst in the right kidney, so I will take the left kidney or vice versa. If there is any abnormality in the kidney, only that kidney can be taken for donation. If there is a small stone in the kidney, that kidney has to be taken for donation. Though stone is a contraindication for donation. Unless it's a diseased donor.
Okay.
And preserve ureteric blood supply. Here, when you are dissecting the ureter, you take the whole tissue between the ureter and the gonadal vein and take them together so that you don't denude the ureteric blood supply.
Yeah. Okay, continue, ma'am.
Donor kidney, it can be harvested by two methods, open life donor nephrectomy and laparoscopic assisted. The technique of renal transplantation, after harvesting kidney, in case of deceased donors, the donor kidney harvested along with Carrel's patch, it is anastomoted to the external iliac artery, and renal vein is anastomoted to the external iliac vein. In case of live donors, the renal vein is direct anastomosed to the internal iliac artery. And this image is showing the implantation of ureter into the bladder mucus. The problems affecting the graft, these includes inadequate vascular anastomosis because of the thrombotic complications like renal artery thrombosis and stenotic complications like renal artery stenosis and hemorrhagic complications. The renal artery or vein thrombosis occurs in around 1% to 5% of the transplants. It is seen during the first week after transplantation, and patient will suddenly present with sudden pain and swelling at the site of the graft. And we have to do ultrasonography to identify this, and most of the patients need urgent surgical exploration and transplant nephrectomy. And in case of renal artery stenosis, it is seen in 10% of the cases, and patients present later after transplantation with increasing hypertension and decreasing renal function. It can be identified by angiography, and we have to do angioplasty. If angioplasty fails, we have to do open surgery and vascular reconstruction.
Renal artery thrombosis, does it require the nephrectomy? Is there no corrective surgery or treatment for that?
No, see, the renal artery thrombosis is a vascular emergency after a transplant. Typically seen, when the kidney output drops suddenly. So if you can rush the patient and do the embolectomy. The renal perfusion can be restarted. Okay, but by and large, if it is not recognized properly and we start giving them some output has fallen, give him some fluids, give him some Lasix, you know, it will increase by 20 ml per hour. And if we sit on it, either because an ultrasonologist will come the next day and do the Doppler and things like that, if we lose that kidney, the only option is transplant nephrectomy. Whereas, if it is done as an emergency, 40 to 50% of the grafts can be saved. Not 100%.
Okay. What is the first sign or symptom to explore?
Sudden drop in the urine output should immediately Doppler should be done with idea to explore.
Yes.
So the OT should be ready. You do the Doppler. If the Doppler shows that your blood flow is good, then you do conservative treatment. If the Doppler is not very sure, always explore.
And what is the cause of this renal artery thrombosis?
Usually it is because some atherosclerosis of the vessels would have occurred in the recipient because of the renal failure and increased this one. That is one. Cyclosporin, all these drugs are thrombogenic. And of course, the technical problem also. If there is a narrowing at the anastomotic site and things like that, yes, it can set off a renal artery thrombosis.
Okay, continue, ma'am.
And urological complications include urinary leak from the anastomotic site or obstruction of the transplant ureter because of the hematoma or lymphocele. And lymphocele, most of the transplant patients will develop lymphocele, and that leads sometimes these lymphocele cause obstruction of the ureter, and in most of the cases it can be drained by USG guided drainage. And in case of the persistent lymphocele, we have to do the surgical drainage for this.
The obstruction of the transplant ureter, technical error. What is the technical error?
So because if anastomotic relates, sir.
Tight anastomosis.
Yeah, anastomotic site.
It's not technical error. What is the technical error of anastomosis? It leads to stenosis.
Usually, the problem why ureteric obstruction occurs after surgery is because of loss of blood supply to the ureter. Okay. If the lack of blood supply is very bad, it necroses and starts urine leak. If it is borderline, it results in stenosis. So, and that presents as ureteroneocystostomy would become narrow. And that is why today most of us put stents to ensure that at least obstruction does not occur immediately. Okay, so that is one. And a hematoma or a lymphocele can press upon the ureter and cause obstruction. Then that becomes an immediate indication for surgery. Okay. Lymphoceles are not common, but just because there is a lymphocele, we need not operate or aspirate. Every time you put in a needle or any drain, you are introducing infection. We would prefer that the patient have a lymphocele, which is not blocking or causing any problem, than to get into trouble. Okay, so that is why this ultrasound guided percutaneous drain, though it is one of the options, if it is obstructing early, then we do this ultrasound guided aspiration. If it is a later event, by which time the lymphocele has got a good wall, then it is always a surgical drainage in the form of a peritoneal window built into the lymphocyte. It's just like our cystogastrostomy. Through the peritoneum, you make a rent into the lymphocyte and just leave it. It will drain. The most often the ureter will be running on the wall of the lymphocyte. And if you happen to cut that, yes, you are in deep shit. That's all.
Okay.
And the causes of the allograft dysfunction, there may be early and late because of the primary non-function like irreversible ischemic damage and delayed function, reversible ischemic injury, and there may be hyperacute or acute rejection and arterial or venous thrombosis of the graft vessel and infection, post-transplant infection like CMV in the graft and mechanical obstruction of the ureter. And the causes of late allograft dysfunction includes chronic rejection and arterial stenosis and recurrence of the original disease in the graft like glomerulus nephritis and hepatitis C. And mechanical obstruction may also cause late graft dysfunction. And the outcomes of kidney transplant, the graft survival after kidney heart liver transplant is more than 90% at 1 year and 80% more than 80% at 5 years. The half-life of grafts in case of deceased donors, it may be 13 years and living unrelated grafts 15 years and living haploid identical grafts 16 years and living identical sibling grafts, it may be 27 years.
Can we go back to the previous slide? Okay. Yeah.
Yes,
now, see, when we say graft dysfunction, a primary non-function, the moment when you say primary, which basically means the cause is not known. It is not irreversible ischemic damage. Okay? Yes. That may be the final event which occurs. Ordinarily, the moment when the perfusion occurs, if the kidney becomes blue, it is called as hyperacute rejection. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Then that is irreversible ischemic damage. That is when you do graft nephrectomy. That is not called primary non-function. Okay? That is hyperacute rejection. Sometimes when the kidney is perfused, it looks good, but there is hardly any urine output or maybe a small amount of output, which you will think everything is fine, it goes on, and you will find that it never improves. Okay? And at some point of time, it may show rejection. But immediately, why did it not work? Even though you take on-table biopsies, there will not be any sign of rejection. So that is primary non-function. Okay? Primary non-function is an entity where we do not know the cause, but still the kidney does not function. When we know that it is arterial thrombosis or it is rejection, it is not primary non-function of the kidney.
Yes.
Delayed function can occur due to several reasons, including prolonged warm ischemia time, prolonged cold ischemia time, the low perfusion pressures at the time when you clamp, unclamp, all these are causes for delayed function, okay? Which may ultimately culminate in acute tubular necrosis and improve. Now, arterial and venous thrombosis of the graft vessels can be due to, like I told you, technical problems. It can be due to drugs, or it can be due to hyperacute rejection, rejection also. So hyperacute rejection is rejection on the table or within the first 24 hours after the graft is perfused. It is called as hyperacute rejection. After 24 hours, within 1 week, it's called as acute rejection. Okay? So you could have an acute rejection on any day, because once the body is exposed to the antigens, you will find that there will be some amount of immune attack occurring on the kidney. Normally, the kidney is supported by immunosuppressant drugs. That is why they all tend to be normal. But if the immunosuppression is not good enough, or if there is a lot of immune complexes which are formed, you will find that acute rejection can occur. Between 1 day and 1 week, it is called as accelerated acute rejection. After that, we call it acute rejection. Again, drug toxicity. Cyclosporine itself can cause acute tubular necrosis. Infections can cause acute tubular necrosis. So all these have to be taken into account, and all these can overlap. Somebody can have a delayed graft function because it's a cadaver kidney and there has been a long total ischemia time. On top of that, you may find that there could be cyclosporine toxicity. On top of that, there could be rejection. So that is why it is our job to see what normally, that is why for a cadaver transplant, we don't start them on cyclosporine till the output stabilizes. Usually by second day or third day, once there is a good output, we start them on cyclosporine. Till that time, we use other drugs to give the immunosuppression. Okay. And we have to, if required, we have to keep doing serial biopsies to make sure that we are not facing a rejection issue. Yeah, next.
Yes, sir.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Can I continue?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, yeah, please.
Yeah. And liver transplantation, sir.
I think it's 10 o'clock already.
No, 1 second.
Rajiv.
Yes, sir.
How do you manage this rejections? You are not treatment of rejection.
Last class, I
thought. Renal transplant, specific drugs, Avala.
ಇದು ರಿಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಟ್ರೀಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಆಯ್ತು ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಪೆಸಿಫಿಕ್ ಆಗಿ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ವಾಂಟ್
ಸ್ಪೆಸಿಫಿಕ್ ಫಾರ್ ಕಿಡ್ನಿ ಅಂತ
ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ನಾಗ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಜಸ್ಟ್
ಪ್ರೈಮರಿಲಿ ವಾಟ್ ವಿ ಗಿವ್ ಇಸ್ ಮೀಥೈಲ್ ಪ್ರೆಡ್ನಿಸೋಲೋನ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಚಾಯ್ಸ್ ಓಕೆ ಇನ್ ಅಕ್ಯೂಟ್ ರಿಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಯೂಶುವಲಿ ದೇ ಆಲ್ ರೆಸ್ಪಾಂಡ್. If they don't, then we have to give them either ATG or change over the immunosuppression to some other form of higher immunosuppression. But typically, acute rejections are always treated with methylprednisolone, what is called as pulse therapy. We give them for 3 days or 5 days, okay, and then see how they respond.
No, no, sir. No, no. Immunosuppressant therapy following a transplant. I'm telling
you. I know. Immunosuppression therapy only. See, normally,
graft rejection.
There will be two or three drugs which are used for immunosuppression. Yeah. One is a steroid, one is mycophenolate, and the third one may be cyclosporine or,
tacrolimus
or one of those. Now, whenever there is an acute rejection, that means the patient is taking these and still having rejection. So what we have to do is we have to give them what we call pulse therapy, which is methylprednisolone in high doses. Okay. 0.5 to 1 gram. And give it for 3 days or 5 days and see what is happening. During this process, we have to see whether the drug levels of tacrolimus are normal or whether it is low. If it is low, it has to be hiked up. So it is like that. If in spite of it, if it is not responding, then we will have to go for higher immunosuppression including anti-thymic globulin and things like that. Second line immunosuppression.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Rajiv? Yes,
long term is only steroids, sir.
I think long term, I think we discuss, see what we do is kidneys are more immunogenic. So by and large, in the first 3 to 3 months or so, you will have to be on three drugs. And then you can go on to 2 drugs depending on how they are. And I think they will be maintained on two drugs for a long time.
See, the immunosuppression is lifelong.
Yeah.
So, and the patient will have steroid and one more drug all throughout their life. Initially, it may be high when we do the transplant. By the end of about 1 month to 6 weeks, they are on to very minimal dose of steroids. And after that, the steroids can be, you know, it cannot be stopped, but very, very minimal. That actually doesn't matter because most of the people with asthma or rheumatoid arthritis will be taking more steroids. But then, the problem with these people is on and off, if there is rejection, we give them high dose steroids, which causes many other problems like, you know, necrosis of the femoral head and things like that, okay, which are more because of acute high dose steroid rather than chronic small dose steroid therapy.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Rajiv, I think
yes, sir.
The renal transplant, I think because of a lot of technical details that were required, has taken the full class. So
yes, sir. Very important as well.
Yeah. Any comments on that?
Technically more difficult.
And then we can maybe schedule the liver and maybe lung transplant for the next class.
Sure, sir. Absolutely. No, I think
anything you want to add to what I think Naga has been a godsend. He has elaborated and clarified a lot of doubts.
Excellent.
Rajiv, can you add anything to that?
Nothing at all, sir. I just want to just make one point about the technique is that, you know, transplantation is unique because it combines GI surgery or urological surgery, which is visceral surgery with vascular surgery.
Yeah.
So, a lot of principles of vascular surgery are extremely important. Certainly, very, very fascinating field. And venous thrombosis and venous complications are actually much, much more difficult and have a devastating impact on the transplant surgical outcome. So, although we talk a lot about arterial problems, venous complications, you know, the veins are much, much more difficult to handle and the lie and the... And the twists and things which can occur. So from a purely surgical point of view, venous complications are dreaded complications. I just wanted to add that, that's all. I mean, yeah.
Okay. So, ending comments, Naga, anything to add to the... I think I have to thank you for, being present, and I think your presence made a huge difference in terms of